Welcome to part 2 of our Dying Light 2 Say Human Developer Tools Guide. In this video, we'll talk about transform tools and how to add new objects to the map. To add a new object, we need the prefab browser window. To open that window, let's jump to Windows and choose prefabs. This window lets you see previews of the objects. By using Atlas, you can find more thematic objects like trees or plants. You can always click All to see all objects. By using Path, you can choose in which folder DevTools should look for objects. Here, you can easily find groups for interiors, vehicles, and more. Let's choose All. In Filter, you can write the name of the object which you want to place on your map. Let's write Tent. Next to the search bar, you can switch between categories. For this part, let's stick to single meshes. The cube icon, meaning a single object with collision. And now let's choose this PAPK tent mesh. Click on it, and by moving your mouse to the viewport, now you can also see your objects in the viewport. By clicking the left mouse button, you can place the object where you want. Let's press Escape to cancel adding more objects. Let's do it one more time by adding a wooden crate. Write wooden crate in the search bar. Click on it and move it to your map. You can hold the Control key on your keyboard to align objects at the right angle to other objects on the map. Click the left mouse button to place it and press Escape. Now let's jump to Windows and choose Scene. In this window, you can see where you added your objects. By clicking on the names, you can quickly select objects you are interested in. You can also select your object in the viewport. Click on an object in your viewport. As you can see, now we're selecting our object. Let's press Escape. To select your object, you need to have activated the first or second icon. Once we have activated our first icon, we can then select our object. Let's press Escape once more and activate the second icon. Bear in mind that this icon also allows us to select our object, but we don't have permission to edit it. So the second icon is used to select an object without the risk of moving or rotating it. By holding the Control key on your keyboard, you can select more objects than one. Let's press the Control key on your keyboard and select our tent. As you can see, both of our objects are selected, as is the case in our scene window. If both objects have this blue field, it means they have been both selected. Let's rotate our camera near to our crate. To move our object, we can use the first or third icon on the toolbar. Now you can probably see some colored arrows, a colored circle, and also some squares. The colors correspond to the XYZ axes, respectively, while these arrows are referred to as the gizmo of an object. The gizmo is displayed in the pivot of the object, that is, the center of the object's local coordinate system. If you have trouble remembering the colors of the axes, identify them with the RGB mode. The X-axis is R or red, the Y-axis is G or green, and the Z-axis is B or blue. To move the object, click and hold one arrow and start moving your mouse. Click on the colored squares around the object to move it along two axes at the same time. Click and hold the center cyan circle to align our objects to other objects or terrain. To rotate our objects, you need to activate the first or fourth icon on the toolbar. You can rotate the objects by using another of three axes, red, blue, or green circles. Let's rotate it. Just click on one of the circles and rotate it. Select a second circle and also rotate it. And finally, click the green one and also rotate it. To scale an object, you need to use the fifth icon from Transform Tools. The first mode lets you scale in relation to three axes. Click on the triangle in the middle and move your mouse. By now, you can tell we're scaling up our object or scaling it down. If you want to move an object in relation to the world coordinate system, first we need to change the gizmo work mode. To do so, go to Windows and choose Attributes. As you can see in the Attributes window, the world mode is chosen by default. In other words, if you move it, it moves in relation to the whole map. Let's zoom out a little to see it better. And now, let's change world to local. Let's choose once more, world, and once more, local. As you can see, the angle of the arrows changed. Now, if you move it, it moves in relation to the object's base. Let's zoom out a little more. And as you can see, we're not going straight up in relation to the world, but with an angle to the left. Let's change to world once more. And now, as you can see, we're going strictly up, not to the left. Let's change once more to the local one and zoom in a little. It also works with rotation. Let's rotate it. Right now, we're rotating in relation to the object. Let's change to world. This time around, we're rotating in relation to the world. Click local once more, and try to notice the overall difference. Changing to local mode allows you to scale the object in different ways. Let's choose the scale option from the toolbar. And now, by grabbing one of the axes and moving our cursor, we can scale the object in just one axis. We can also grab one of the triangle wires and move our cursor to scale the object in relation to two axes. There's one more option to scale objects. The other mode can be found on the toolbar next to the scale object icon. The name of this icon is Scale by Extents. This mode lets you scale objects in relation to their extents. Grab one of its sides to scale it. At the same time, you move its pivot so that it stays in the center of the scaled object. You can also scale the object by grabbing the edge of its outline. That way, the object can be scaled in more than one direction at the same time. If you want to grab a side obscured by another in front of it, press and hold the Ctrl key on your keyboard. That will make the front side unclickable. You can use snapping options to be more precise while moving the object. Let's choose the first icon on the toolbar that will allow us to move our object. And now let's activate our movement snapping option by clicking the first icon in the right corner of the viewport. We have activated our move snap. Now when I'm going to try to move our object, we can see some kind of grid. It will show us how much we're going to move our object. It also works for the other axes. You can modify this grid. To modify it, let's click the small triangle icon next to the Move Snap option. In Grid Steps, you can choose a different value. Let's choose 0.1 for this value. For this value, let's choose 5, and for this value, let's choose 10. Let's select one of the axes, and you can see how our grid changed for this axis, as well for this axis, and also for this axis. It also works for rotation, so let's activate it. Snapping can also work for rotation. Changing it, it works the same way, so triangle and change to the angle you want to have in snapping. As you can see, this angle is activated. Scaling works in the same way, so by activating it and choosing the scale option, you can also see the snapping when scaling. To deactivate this, let's uncheck these three icons. I can now move this object freely, rotate it freely, and also scale it freely, without any snapping. To duplicate your objects, let's click on the first selection and move tool. And by holding Shift, you can duplicate this item. Press Escape to deselect it, and let's jump to the scene window. In our scene window, you can see all the objects that are placed on our map. There are two categories, sandbox and level. Objects from the sandbox category will not be visible in our game. So if we want to make the stand and crate visible in our game, we need to move them to the level. So let's collapse this down. Select our level and open this level category to edit it. Right mouse button, click open, and now let's select one wooden crate. By holding Shift, you can select all of them. Also, you can select one of them, and by holding Ctrl, you can select the one you want by hand. Now, let's click the right mouse button and choose Move To, then Town. As you can see, these objects jump to the level category, so they're going to be visible in our game. We can also check the Map Start to move our map start position to the space close to our edits. So you can easily check how it looks in our game without needing to run to this place. So, to save our change, let's click on Level and click Save and Reload. Now, our progress is saved. As you can see, this new object provides some kind of mess in our level because the whole town is closed in a group. How can we make this group ourselves? Let's open our level one more time, select one of these crates, and by holding Ctrl, let's select all other objects we added to our map. Let's click the right mouse button and click Create Prefab. Prefab is like a folder or group that contains all the objects you put there. It is very helpful to keep everything in order. So let's write the name of this prefab. Maybe PK Outpost TUT. And now, save. The prefab was successfully created. We can also save and reload our level. The good thing about a prefab is that you don't need to open this level to edit inside of these prefabs. We can only open inside of this prefab. For example, open and set as target. So that means that every object you add to your map at this point will automatically go to this prefab. So, as you can see, this new wooden crate jumps straight to this prefab because I set it as a target, meaning that every new object that we add to our map will jump straight to this prefab. We can also create prefabs inside prefabs, meaning a group inside groups. For example, we want to create a group for these crates. Let's select them, right mouse button, create prefab, and write PK outpost crates. Click save. Now, as you can see, I have a global prefab for our whole change. I have a separate prefab for my crates, and I have the stands freely in our main prefab. To save this change, let's click on it and click save and reload. In this tutorial, we created two prefabs, PK Outpost TUT and also PK Outpost Crates. Each prefab you created can be found in the prefab browser window. Let's click the prefab browser, choose the prefabs category, and write the name of the prefab you created. As you can see, now I can see the prefabs I created, so I can click them and place them somewhere else on the map. I don't need it for now, so let's press escape. Now, let's check how our change looks and behaves in the game. Let's click the play icon and yes to save our progress. Our game has loaded. Here you can see our player, so map start point works okay. Here you can check our change. So as you can see, there are visible crates. We can jump on them, walk on them, and do some parkour on our tent. So everything works just fine. And that's all for part 2. In the next video, we explain how the environmental and dynamic lighting work. Thanks for watching.